So, this awesome dude over there, that's Frank Karliczek. He started the whole UnCloud thing. And he's been involved in the KDE community before he was doing all the cloudy things. He's now staying at my place, which is quite interesting.
Yeah, and this awesome dude over there is Jos Potsvliet. He's was also involved in KDE a lot in the marketing. He's now rocking the OpenSUSE community, right, as a community manager. Yeah. And thanks a lot for inviting me and let me stay at your guest room.
Yeah. The only downside of that is, of course, you have to deal with data over there, because that's our dog, Popcorn. So, but of course, you don't really care much about dogs and that kind of stuff. You are interested in something else here, UnCloud, clouds. So what do we want? Why do we care about that stuff? Well, we all want, of course, to have this warm and fuzzy feeling of not having to worry about our data, right? That's the whole concept of cloud, right? The cloud is that thing that, you know, is a safe place for your data. They call it a amorphous network of servers somewhere. So they keep your data safe. You don't have to worry about your stuff, and you can reach it always everywhere. Now, there are a lot of different clouds out there, and this talk is not about these ones. These are the big ones. You know, big companies have these things they call cloud computing stuff that does compute and well, anything uninteresting for a normal home user. Stuff we care about is this, right? Having your data available on your mobile phone or your laptop and having it being synchronized, actually. Now, currently, if you use that kind of stuff, you have to put your head in the sand, or if there's no sand, follow my dog and put it in the shoe. You have to live with the fact that there are a lot of evil clouds out there. Actually, most of the current solutions people use are, well, more or less evil and dangerous and suck up your data somewhere. So this is, of course, a very typical problem, right? I mean, big companies like to lock down your data somewhere and then, you know, later on tell you, hey, if you don't upgrade to the new version, you can't, you know, open these files anymore. That kind of stuff has been happening for quite a while already. Of course, in the meantime, there's this big bunch of geeks out there. You know, a lot of them are here, and we always have had this tendency to try and, you know, kick the asses of the big guys and try to do something about the fact that they're trying to eat our data. And that is, of course, what UnCloud is all about. So 2010, this man here at the beautiful place in California, San Diego, right, announced that, you know, he was sick and tired of it and was going to write this thing called UnCloud, have your own cloud. And, well, that's what he did. The end result is UnCloud, and he's going to tell you what the end result actually was.
Okay, thanks. UnCloud is an open source project, which means HGPL. The interesting part is that you can actually run it on your own machine. So you can actually use all these great cloud services like synchronize your files, synchronize your calendar, synchronize your address book, and so on. But you don't have to give away your data. You don't have to store your data somewhere else. You can actually store your data on your own machine. That's the whole point. You have the functionality, the features, but without losing control over your data. UnCloud is open source. It's HGPL licensed. You can download it from our website, put it on your own machine. We also have a startup company now, which offers commercial support. So if you are a company and you want to have some SLA, you want to have some special modifications, you want to have telephone support, you want to have a consultant sitting in your conference room and helping you with setting everything up. There's a startup company now to help you with that. If you don't need this because you're able to configure an Apache and you know what PHP is, just download it from a web page, put it on the machine, and it just works. So what is actually, what is UnCloud all about? UnCloud, the core of UnCloud is enabling access to your data. So what we have is a nice web interface. I'll show you a screenshot in a minute, where you can configure everything. You can create folders, put your stuff in folders, and you can actually can also drag and drop from your desktop to your browser and so on. We support protocols like WebDAV, where you can actually mount it directly as a network drive at your desktop, Mac, Windows, Linux, without an additional client. But we also have an additional special client, a desktop syncing client that you can download, put in your sys tray, and it syncs all your stuff locally to your hard disk. If someone knows Dropbox or Google Drive, it's just exactly the same functionality. And we're also working on Android and iOS clients at the moment. The Android client has a beta, that's also already beta available. The iOS client really, really, really soon. This is a screenshot of the web interface. I think it's really nice. We use all the latest HTML5 and Ajax features, drag and drop supported, for example. We have an inline editors for text files. We can generate slideshows. We can have a music player. We have a movie player soon. All the nice features. This is a screenshot of our Android client where you can look at all your files. You can upload stuff, download stuff from your phone or your tablet. But we actually can do a little bit more than the standard features from Dropbox or from Google Drive. We can integrate with other systems too. That's the benefit if everything runs on your own machine, right? So we can do LDAP integration, Active Directory, all kinds of authentication. So if you want to have a single sign solution where you can, for example, log in with the same credential into your Samba server or into your own cloud, it's completely integrated. We have features like automatic backup. So if you save a file in own cloud, you can configure it in a way that it's automatically stored at a second machine. So we have hot failover. And we can also import and export data. That's also very important. Because if you decide that you don't want to install OwnCloud on your own root server, for example, or your desktop, and you decide to get OwnCloud from a service provider, and a few months later you don't like the service provider anymore because it's probably not reliable or expensive or whatever, or there's a better one out there, we have just an export button where you can export your complete user account, import in a different installation, and everything is there again. So it's really good for the user, not so much for the service provider, of course. We have versioning of files. So every file you store in OwnCloud, it can be versioned, you can roll back, do undeletes. We have encryption, which is an encryption of the transfer at the moment with SSL, and encryption on the server-side encryption. And we also work on client-side encryption for the next version. We have awesome sharing features, so you can click on a file or a calendar or a gallery entry and say, hey, I want to share this with this other person or with a group of people. Or you can even generate public links that you can send by email. Someone clicks on the link and can look at your holiday pictures, for example. So I really think that it's a really stupid concept on the internet at the moment that you, holiday pictures, vacation pictures, a really good example, that you have to give up the control over your pictures only because you want to show it to your family, right? You have to upload it to Flickr or to Facebook or whatever, or to Dropbox, and you give up control over this stuff. I mean, there are evil SLAs in place or terms of service. And with OwnCloud, you can actually keep the files under your control with just one click, send someone a link to it. We have notifications. So really nice notification if something is happening on your own cloud. For example, on KDE desktop, we have push notifications already. So you get a nice pop-up on your desktop if something happening on your machine, if a shared file is changed, for example. But OwnCloud is more than just files. So we have also a calendar and contacts. We can sync this with desktop clients, with KDE Contact, for example, or with all kinds of clients, with mobile clients too. But we also have a really, really nice web interface, so you can actually choose what you want to use. Bookmark syncing, music player, photos, all kinds of stuff. And the whole point of it, that's really what's different about OwnCloud, that we, as OwnCloud, we don't run a service. We don't have any servers. We only do the software. So we provide the software to you that you can run your own cloud installation. That's a really interesting thing here. This is just a brief overview. We support different storage backends on the left, local storage obviously, but also we can integrate Amazon S3, for example, or Google Drive or Dropbox. You can mount this into your own cloud, and then access it from all kinds of devices like desktop, tablets, and so on. Use case scenario is you can, if you have an existing storage like a Samba server or a NAS or something like that, you can just download OwnCloud, install it additionally to your existing device, and just connect it with it. Then if you can connect it to an LDAP server, for example, if you want a single sign login, and then you have all the nice sharing and syncing features. Oh, I think this is not my slide anymore. This is now your slide. As you can all see. I think this slide means that if you have installed OwnCloud, everything is fine, right?
Exactly. Or if you have any questions, you can ask them now before we go on to a couple of other things. Are there any questions? Yeah. Come on, think about how cool it is, right? I mean, we all know Google Drive, right? That's where they put your data, and of course, we all know that they're going to index it. Well, you know, use Google Drive with OwnCloud, so use it as a storage for OwnCloud. And then have OwnCloud encrypt your files. Bye, Google, you'll just get one big binary blob. Have fun. Beautiful, right? Owned. Questions?
I already downloaded OwnCloud and tried it out, but I didn't get a clue how to synchronize contacts in Mozilla Thunderbird with OwnCloud. Could you give a quick introduction to this topic?
Yeah, sure. For synchronization of contacts and calendar entries, we support CalDAV and CARTAV as protocols. And I think they are natively supported in the Mozilla applications, if I'm right. You go in OwnCloud, you go to the personal settings page, and there you have two URLs, the CalDAV and CARTAV URLs. Just copy it and put it in your application, and then it should work. More questions? Nothing? Okay.
I'm an OwnCloud user. I'll have you download it. My calendar and notes, and not my calendar, address, timetable, synchronization works good with my Android, but I just gave the Android Linux own OwnCloud client a try and put my picture folder to it. It holds 40 gigabytes of pictures. Well, it went yesterday, several hours, the day before. Will that become faster? So I didn't find any index or something like that on my machine here, on my local machine. Did I overlook it, or is there no index? Will that ever be, I synchronize all?
With index, you mean like an index of your files, your local files? Yeah, there is an index, of course. There's a local database. It's in a .csync subdirectory. And there's an index database from all your files. And I mean, that's if you have lots of data, 40 gigabytes, and you have a slow upstream, it can take a while. That's OK. Well, normally we support compression, HTTP compression, so it really shouldn't take that long. If you want, we can debug this later. But normally it should be quite fast. But perhaps there's a problem with the connection or something. We can debug it later if you want. Ah, very secure. That's good. More questions?
What kind of restrictions can I make for the users? So can I tell them, yeah, you are not able to upload MP3 or something like that?
There is restrictions. We have different groups of users. So you can have an admin group. Admins can install add-ons, like create other users and so on, and then you can create subgroups, and you can give special rights to the groups. A filter for the allowed file types, this is actually in our bug tracker already as a to-do entry, and this should be relatively easy to do, but that's not there at the moment. But it will be, yeah, it's a common request.
What about the user registration portal? Right now we have to, as an administrator, I have to create different accounts and give the passwords, and I would like to have a feature that the user can registrate and I can give them the rights. Is that possible, or is that a feature?
Okay. Yeah, that's an interesting topic. I want to answer this a little bit more in a longer way, that originally the idea behind OwnCloud is that this is for individuals, like home users. So just take it, put it on your own machine, and have all your stuff under your control. As an OwnCloud company, we also support this for companies, like bigger high availability installations. But the thing is that a lot of service providers also want to use OwnCloud. We get lots and lots of requests from them. And for service providers, I think the feature that you mentioned is very interesting, that basically everybody can sign up and gets an account. That's not a very good feature for home users, obviously.
No, that's fine.
So because of that, we don't have this at the moment. But it's also a common request from service providers, and we will do this, that you can sign up, and then you have something like a few gigabytes for free, and then if you pay a little bit more, you get more space, something that's a feature that service providers want to have. And we will do this in the future, definitely. But we don't have this at the moment because this is, doesn't make sense for home users, of course.
What's the roadmap looking like right now? Can you say something about that?
Yeah, the thing is that we have a 3-month release schedule for OwnCloud. So we decided to develop it really fast. So we have feature releases every 3 months and bug fix releases in between. The planned features for OwnCloud, OwnCloud 5, which is an coming version, is we want to improve the encryption system a lot, because currently the files are encrypted. Well, no, not really true. First you use the password of the user to encrypt a key file, and then with this key file the data is encrypted. We use this because if you want to change your password, this is really fast. We don't have to decrypt and encrypt every single file. That's just a performance improvement. The problem with this solution is it's so fast, so secure, that if you forget your password, there's no way to recover it. I mean, we have a password recover feature in OwnCloud, so you can get a new password and log in again and access your calendar and stuff like that. But your files, the password is the key, so there's no way to recover your data. And we will implement a proper public key infrastructure for this in the next version, that you can have something like a recovery key and put this in a safe place, and then later use it to recover your password. So this is planned. Then we will have a movie player and a PDF viewer, PDF ebook reader, and a small presentation program that's already in the works. And then we have another really, really cool but relatively secret feature. I don't want to talk about this. It will be really cool. More questions?
How about using certificates for authentication?
Yeah, that's actually in implementation at the moment, that you can use an SSL certificate. Not only for encryption of the data, but also for authentication. That's in the works at the moment. Will be released really, really soon.
I had a Synology rack server, so I installed OwnCloud on that server, and I had my music collection already on that server. So I moved the collection to the folder where OwnCloud stored it, but the collection did never show up. So can I manually start the indexing process or?
Yeah, that's a common question. The thing is that we implement a lot of advanced features on top of the stupid storage. So we have like the encryption, we have the versioning, we have access control list, and remote storage and all kinds of features. Because of that, it doesn't work very well if you modify files directly under storage without OwnCloud noticing it. And there is basically only one way to that I could recommend, or two ways to do this. First of all, upload it via the WebDAV interface instead of do it directly on the storage. This works. Or it also works if you create a new account. So if you create a complete new account, put your files in the home directory, and then log in for the first time, then it works. But if you change the files without OwnCloud noticing it, it's, we have a file system cache in place, and this fails in this use case.
Are there any plans for an web API, like JSON RPC or something like that, to integrate it into other applications?
Yeah. Do you mean for files or for anything? I mean, yeah, for file access. At the moment, we really want to stick to open protocols as much as possible. So file access, we really want to use WebDAV as much as possible. We already have a few APIs which provide features that are not available on WebDAV. So like for the syncing, for example, like a nice call where you get the latest changed file, so the syncing client is faster, and a few other small things. But the file access itself, I think we want to stick with WebDAV there instead of implementing a second file access API. I mean, if there's a real use case for this, it's very easy to do. We just want to keep it as clean as possible, so not two APIs for the same use case.
Do you have a solution for people running Outlook?
No. No, no.
He said something about open protocols, right?
there is a very nice PHP library called setpush, implemented by the Zarafa guys, and this is an active sync implementation, and it should be really, really easy to implement this in OwnCloud, but it's not done yet. I don't know if someone is working on it, but should be relatively easy. But about the calendar, the address book stuff, I want to stress that we are not replacing a groupware server here. I mean, if you're really, really serious about groupware features, we recommend to use something like Colab or Zarafa or OpenExchange. That's way more capable. This is more like for up to 10 users, I would say.
Is it possible to switch off certain features, like pictures, calendar, contacts?
Yes, that's under the apps, right? You can just say like, hey, I don't like my pictures. And then it really shouldn't work anymore, and it doesn't.
Okay.
So yes, it's disabled.
Is it just for one person now, or for everyone?
Frank?
No, that's for everyone. This is the administrator the administrator decides what plugins are installed, and then this is configured for every user. More questions?
Nice.
You mentioned your fast upgrade schedule. And I just refrain from upgrading 3 to 4 because of my Android synchronizing clients. Will the application interfaces ever be downward compliant?
Of course, that should. The thing with the Android client, we have two different code bases at the moment, and they're both in beta state. So that's, it works more or less. I don't know which one you used. It's not stable yet, unfortunately. So really hope that in 2 to 3 weeks we can release the final Android client, and this will be stable and will work with every OCloud version. This is work in progress, unfortunately. No, the interface will be stable then. Yeah. More questions?
So you mentioned there's a way to sync to OnCloud server. So how do you do this? And is then automatically fallback, so if my primary server fails?
The synchronization is really implemented comparable to Dropbox or to Google Drive. So you have a desktop syncing client, and you can configure it to sync one specific OnCloud folder to one specific local folder. And if a file changes on one of the sites, it's synced to the other side automatically. And if you don't have internet access or if your server fails, the files stay in place till it's working again.
So there's no feature to have a primary server and a fallback server, which syncing on their own. So it's done by the clients, is it?
Yeah, that's true. For high availability, setup. There are lots of tools in place for doing high availability HTTP applications, and we recommend to use something like that, like the HTTP load balancer, for example. We don't do this ourselves. We also don't have our own web server, so we rely on the existing web infrastructure stuff, and also for the hot failover.
Sorry again, but the question is what is done by the files? Because you know, I have in mind. Let's say a primary server and having a backup server, so my files are redundant in case of a hard drive failure on the first server.
Yeah, I mean we can, like I said, duplicate all the files on a second server. Of course, this involves some configuration that you have to go to a second server and make it a primary one. For a really really hot failover, we recommend to use a distributed database and distributed file system like the cluster file system from Red Hat, for example, or other distributed file systems or NFS solution if you're in one hosting center. So there are solutions for that, but it's nothing we really do in OwnCloud. In OwnCloud we concentrate on the functionality, and we use all the existing web stuff for the other parts. So for example, we don't do SSL encryption on ourselves because the web server can do this. And so on. And it's the same with the HRI. But what's this, the real question? I don't know.
No, it's fine for me.
Okay. More questions?
I'm just curious, is there like a technical reason for you to be providing the user space binary at 64-bit only for the macOS, because you're locking out millions of Intel users with Core Duo? So maybe you want to check your Xcode flags next time you build?
I will pass this request to our developer, that's true. We just have restricted resources and we can't support every operating system with every architecture, so we decided to focus on a few important ones. But actually, if quite a few people requested 32-bit Mac build, so we'll do this.
Does OwnCloud support SCP or Async?
Actually, no. This would mean that we have to implement our own SSH server, which is probably not a good idea. So, not really, no. If you want to access the files over the network in a secure way, we recommend SSL with WebDAV. Yeah. 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 I mean, we use a tool called CSync. which is use some of the similar concepts as rsync, but it's way more advanced because it supports bidirectional syncing, which rsync, this is really not working that well. So I don't know if you tried it. You have a problem with deleting files, for example. If you delete a file on one end and then sync again, it appears again. So this is really broken for this use case. So the tool we use, C-Sync, is way better there. More questions?
How do you manage file conflicts?
That's a very good question. file conflict is if you change a file on the server and at a client offline, and then you go online again, and then you sync, and then the syncing algorithm detects that it was actually changed on both sides. Then it the newest change wins, and the other change is stored in parallel with a dot conflict. Postfix behind the file name. So we hope that the newest change, that this is actually what the user expects, but the user never loses any data, so the user can always look at the other file too. And also this works together with our versioning. So in the versioning there are also all the old versions available. What we don't do is try to merge the files somehow, because this never works with binary files, obviously. I mean, in theory, with ODF, you could look inside a zip file and merge the XML data, but I am not sure if this is a good idea. So we just provide both files, and the user has to do something about this.
About the synchronization, is always the complete file synchronized or just the delta?
At the moment, it's only always the complete file. But this is also to do for the next development cycle that we do and do this in chunks. Yeah. Questions?
My question is a little bit concerning hardware requirements, or what is the minimum? And the second question is, it is also possible to run it on a DSL modem like Fritzbox or something else?
If you come to the OwnCloud booth, I have a small server there, ARM based, which is 4 centimeters long, takes 3 watts of power, and this runs OwnCloud just fine. So I don't think we have any real minimum requirement. Of course, it boils down to the question of how many users are simultaneously on this server. I mean, of course, we need a little bit more power if you have whatever 100 users all the time running, clicking on stuff. But it's quite fast, I would say. So it runs just fine on NAS devices or on routers. So yeah, don't expect to saturate a gigabit line with this kind of hardware, but for normal use cases, it's just okay.
We're at our time end, so I would suggest for any more questions, you come to the booth and just bother Frank himself or one of the other OwnCloud developers there. And don't forget to come by the OpenSUSE booth for a beer. See you all.
Thanks.